Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you praise. We give you glory. Thank you, Lord God, for your blessings that make rich and add no sorrow in them. Thank you, King of glory, that when you bless us, no man can curse us. Thank you, O God, because you lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. And thank you, Father God, because getting born again is the best decision we've ever made in our lives, O God. And we marvel daily about your goodness and your love and your mercy. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless every person listening to this video, Lord God, watching, oh Lord Jehovah God, wherever they are. And may your mercies lead them, oh God, to the right direction, oh God. And may you speak to them and reveal to them anything that Satan would want to use in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Ooh, one boy, the first one to watch. Hallelujah. Amen. So, it's been several weeks now of the Lord leading me to really talk to his children about altars of darkness and about covenants. And it's not been an easy message. It's been a very hard message, actually. So we're going into week 5 of talking about covenants and altars and all that. That's at Sozo Church of God. And the Lord just told me to slow it down and just talk about that a lot. And as I come back from America, I'll be talking a lot about prayer. And the Lord said, stay on prayer, even if it takes you, you know, the rest of the year just to teach on prayer until people get it. And the thing with altars and covenants and those kind of things is that if you are bound, very often part of the bondage will include just keeping you bound. Yes, so that you never get the message, you never get to hear about it, you never realize that you are bound. You always think that it's other people. And given my own case in particular, I've shared how in 2012, before I attended my first Sozo session, I actually believed that the Sozo session was going to be more for my husband, not for me. And it turned out to be the beginning of the rest of my life. And, you know, all from the place of thinking that I'm okay, you know, it's my husband who needs to deal with it and all that, you know, and deal with some things and all. And that was just it. But by the mercies of God, I mean, I got to hear about it. I thank God for his goodness and for his mercy, even when you're proud and foolish and thinking that other people are the ones who should be listening to a message. Then, you know, the Lord releases us into his goodness and his love. There's a place of intimacy with God that will lead you into a place of blessing, into a place where God will look at you and say, not this one. Satan, you're not going to have this one. You're not going to touch this one. And that's what I want to talk about today, about the way the Lord blesses us, you know, and the blessings of the Lord and how they increase in us. So many believers, sadly enough, if I was to give a statistic, I would say about 90% of believers, maybe higher, actually walk under curses, even though the Lord has already blessed them, but they walk under curses because of ignorance. I was just having a discussion with a relative who's so dear to my heart, but we can't come to an agreement about the issue of anti-Semitism. You know, so you send me things to do with the Jews and everything, and I look at them, and yes, you could be right about some things, but the Lord has told me I cannot engage in that kind of a path, because it's very, very clear that if you curse anyone who's a son of Abraham, then you are a descendant of Abraham. And by the way, all of us who are born again become the descendants of Abraham. It's part of the blessing of giving our lives to Yeshua. If you curse anyone who's a descendant of Abraham, then you are cursed. If you bless anyone who's a descendant of Abraham, you are blessed. And God does not mince words about that. And I know that there are things that we believe maybe God is speaking proverbially on, and but then the Lord is not using proverbs in this kind of situation. He means just that. And it's one of the things that causes so many people to be cursed, but they don't even realize the fact that they hate Jews, the fact that they judge Israel, the fact that they come against Israel and say all sorts of things about Israel. And I had said that I'll talk about the Islamic agenda. One of the things that Muslims are doing is that they've become very good at their PR. So they got to learn along the way that if they have, they keep on bombing everybody and jihading and everything, that it's going to turn people away from the faith, that violence is not going to work. So they decided to choose a different path. And part of the path is to the point where today you actually receive a message, Ramadan Kareem, and it says that apparently, you know, Ramadan, I don't know, brings a spirit of, I don't know, generosity and all that stuff. And really, unless unless you're walking with spiritual eyes, you will fail to miss it. First, personally, for me, I was very excited when I got that message today, because I got to know, oh, it's on. And for me, my prayer right now is the word of God that says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And for me, I'm saying, Lord God, as Muslims are fasting, they are seeking you with all of your heart. They might not know that they're looking for Jehovah, but God, reveal yourself to them. And the last time by day I prayed that prayer, a lot of people really, really, really got saved. My children are here. I hope I can keep them quiet. Yeah, so, you know, hi, how are you? Those are not even my children. Okay, just children coming to say hi. I tell you, yes, I attract children. I guess I love children, so I attract children. So that's the prayer right now, you know, just declaring that as the Muslims are fasting, as the Muslims are praying, that they will be led to the Lord. The main thing I really felt I needed to talk about is the blessings of the Lord, yeah? And in particular, I want to use the example of Peter. For the longest time, I used to ask God, because this is something God did to me as well. I'll be driving in 2012 and I'd hear, Kathy, do you love me? I'll say, yes, Lord, I love you. And God asked me that so many times. And, you know, I began to understand why Peter said, God, you know that I love you. But as I look back now, I understand why. You know, for Peter denied Jesus three times. He denied Jesus three times before the cock crowed, even though he had said he could never deny Jesus. And Jesus understood that there's a curse that comes to those who deny him, to those who reject him, to those who refuse to accept him. And he understood that even though Peter had earlier believed, the fact that he had actually, renounced Jesus three times, Satan was going to use that to accuse him. So Jesus then asked Peter three times as well, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? You know, so I kept asking God, why three times? And then for me, why did he ask me more than three times? Why does he keep asking me from time to time? What Jesus was doing was that he was redeeming Peter from the curse and from the accusation of Satan, even to the point where he said, on this rock, I will build my church. And Satan could not touch him anymore. He said, the gates of hell cannot prevail against him. And what Jesus did was redeem Peter by asking him three times, the same three times that he had denied Jesus. And in that entire process, he actually saved Peter from every accusation of Satan based on the curses that come upon people who deny God and choose any other God. You see, for Peter, in a case where he had denied Jesus, what he had done is that he had loved his life more than he had loved Jesus Christ. And so to preserve his own life, he said, no, I've never seen him a day in my life. I don't know him. I don't know who he is. And in so doing, he was actually raising up another idol who was himself. And if you look at, I think it's Deuteronomy 27 from verse 15, it lays out the things that will cause you to be cursed. And the first thing that will cause you to be cursed is if you have any other God other than Jehovah. And that includes, by the way, when we love our children more than we love Jesus Christ. When we love our own faiths, you know, the places where we go and fellowship, when we love them more than we love Jesus Christ. When we love anything to do with, ourselves and preserving our own lives, like when we are threatened because we are Christians and we deny Christ, it means that that is idolatry in itself, including... my daughter has just come and gone. Including when we, we want to look better than when we love Jesus Christ. And by the way, this happens all the time. We are around unbelievers and we hide our faith. You know, we're not supposed to like necessarily shout out our faith. But the moment that you begin to try and cover up Jesus Christ, it means that you have other carved images, which could be your image, which could be how you are perceived. You don't want to lose friends. You don't want to lose business. You don't want people to judge you. So you don't want anybody to associate you with Christ, and you're like, oh, he's a personal savior. But when you are asked whether you're a Christian, what do you then say? When you are asked why you don't do things, what do you then say? I was talking to a lady just shared something very, very deep about two of her children. And I know she wouldn't mind me sharing this, but also I don't name names. So, I mean, really, how are you going to figure out which woman it is out of all the women? And she was telling me how her children go to a particular faith church, which I'll not name because people catch feelings. And it's not their faith. And she was telling me about how one of the children seems to be moving away from God, seems to be getting into nightmares and just all sorts of things. And asked me, could it be the school? school? And I said, yes, definitely, it's a school. Because the school upholds a different altar from the altar that you uphold. So the child keeps getting sick because of that altar. And I said, oh, and by the way, you know, when I have, hi, Josh, when I had the older one, she refused to bow down. She would fast and pray. She got into a lot of trouble and she was summoned by the school and told, what is this that you're doing? And she said, I don't believe in your God. The God that I believe in, this is who he is. And the child, just by faith in primary school, described the God that she believes in, the God of the Bible, and said, that's the God I will uphold. And nothing happened to her. By the way, she was not removed from the school, as a lot of us normally will fear. And, you know, she continued in the school, but she was chased away, of course, and she was labeled and all that. But the thing is, this child, the enemy could not touch her because she took her position. So you take your child to a school that doesn't uphold the God that you serve, but can you teach your child how to stand up for that God? How to stand up and draw a mark and say, I will not bow down to any idol. As we're fellowshipping with this dear lady, I also learned something new. The Lord just began to speak to me and tell me, you know, when the children of Israel went into captivity and in the book of Daniel, it's described when they entered into captivity for the umpteenth time, you know, they took quite a number of the children of Israel together with the artifacts from the house of God and everything. And it was completely plundering the things of God. And then it is mentioned in particular about four different youths, you know, four young people, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. But please notice that Daniel is not at any point referred to. I think it was Belteshazzar. I never even remember his the name that he was given by the Babylonians, you know, because you don't see him being referred to using that name. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were the names that were given by these guys, but they don't choose their original names. But this particular guy, Daniel, he was a boy of prayer. He was a young man of prayer. The Bible tells us about how even when the decree was made, the people were going to be killed if they don't bow down to idols, when the decree was made that they were going to be thrown into a lion's den, Daniel literally just got up. He went up to the upper room and he opened the windows and he continued to pray as was his normal custom. A lot of us bow down to idols all the time. And the thing is, when you bow down to idols, you're going to fall under a curse. If you read Deuteronomy 28, it has 54 different curses. 54. It's almost four times the number of blessings. 54 different curses. And a lot of us Christians, the Lord was warning me today as I was going to the teacher service commission, because I was ministering on this word as well. A lot of us believers are bowing down to idols. We are fashioning idol calves. Things like, you know, you are abroad. And one of the things I notice about people who are abroad is that they're caught up in shifts and they're caught up in making the next money and they're caught up in making all this money until they don't really spend time in prayer, until they miss church. They don't go to the place of fellowship and worship. And what is that? That is idolatry. In Sozo Church, I mean, when I'm around, when I'm ministering, it is so pathetic. And I'll use the word pathetic. It is totally pathetic that people fill up the sanctuary, but then when I go away, like I'm going away, you find that the numbers decrease day by day. And you know what? The Lord is giving a warning. That is idolatry. And that's the thing. We have upheld, men and women of God, we have upheld our jobs. We've upheld our husbands and our wives. We have upheld this life. We have upheld our reputations, and they are becoming carved idols, and they are becoming gods beside Jehovah. You know, you're serving Jehovah, but there's a God beside him. Because a lot of us focus on idolatry, where you're worshiping another God but not Jehovah. But we forget that God said there will never be another God above me, but also beside me. Okay? So it's critical that we understand this and stop with the idolatry. Because all the curses, okay, the 54 curses in Deuteronomy 28, they are actually, they begin by disobedience, you know. And the first thing, if you look at Deuteronomy 27 from verse 15, the first thing that God talks about is if you worship any other God, if you bow before any other God. And bowing before gods, by the way, is something as simple as preserve your life. Just bow to the idol calf, even though we know what you believe in, you are going to be just fine. It is your bosses telling you at lunchtime that you cannot go and pray, you need to stay in. It is as simple as being required to be at a team building on a Sunday. You know, one thing I admire about Seventh-day Adventists is that they make it very clear, I'm sorry, it is on a Saturday, I will not come. I really admire that about them. And I know as Christians we insist that Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. But still at the end of the day, when your job becomes more critical than your God, when you don't feel anything, when by the way, you know, if you're called for a team building and all that, you should be able to still say, I will wake up a little bit earlier on that Sunday and worship the Lord and have my Sabbath with God and my moment with God and lift up the name of God and maybe even gather together with other believers and have a little service before we do. But also the other thing is our offices. We are placed there as priests. We are sent to our marketplaces. We are sent to wherever we are sent as priests. You never put down the priesthood. But what have we done? You're so afraid that someone will find out that you're born again and therefore they might not give you business. So what do? You hang the coat of salvation somewhere and then you pick it up in the evening. That is idolatry because you prefer not to offend. You prefer so that the feelings of that person are more important than the Lord himself. And I'm not saying, by the way, that you need to enter the places of work and say, praise God, I'm born again. No. But people ought to be able to look at you and be able to tell that you're a believer based on your values, based on your dressing, based on the things that you will not do, based on the things you will not say. We have believers in places where people are talking sinful talk, you know, vulgarities and everything. And you continue and even laugh. You know, you're a little uncomfortable, but you laugh. Yeah, they're saying, ha, 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 ki, you. Yeah? Really, what is that? We are bowing down to idols. And the Lord is saying that a lot of believers are walking under curses. You have diseases you have no business having. Who told you that when you grow old, you need to have arthritis? Where in the Bible is it written that there are diseases that come out of old age? Nowhere. The Lord says, I am the Lord, your healer. So he has healed all your diseases. So if you have any sickness that is not bowing down to the name of Jesus Christ, guess what? You have moved to being under a curse. If you have, brokenness that is just out of control, financial, strife and struggle, you just live from hand to mouth. You can't even explain where your salaries are going through. You need to check what the reason is behind the curses that have come upon you, because the Lord has blessed us beyond any curse. Do you know that when the Lord's blessings are manifesting in your life, the Lord will even cause for, even though you're going to have a puncture in your car, you'll have a puncture at the right place. Right next to a petrol station. Tried and true, I have found it. It doesn't mean that trouble will not come, but trouble will even find itself diarized at the point at which it will come. When sickness comes, it bows before the name of Jesus Christ as you declare, I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. Either that, or maybe the Lord tells you, go to hospital. You get to the hospital and they can't find anything, but the Lord wanted you to go to that hospital so that you can minister to somebody else. The blessings of the Lord make rich and they add no sorrow. You will find yourself getting into places and people are just ushering you in. People are giving you information. Information will pursue you, jump on you, and overtake you so that you may know how to pray, in which direction, and what to do. Today, it was very interesting. You know, our children are in two sets. You know, we have two older ones, two younger ones. And I realized that since the two younger ones were born, I've not really taken any prophetic action on them. In no time, the Lord just began to speak to me. There's one of them who tends to be so accident prone, you know, until I don't even give her things because I don't want her to break them. Then the Lord spoke to me and asked me, why is your child accident prone? That is a curse. What is that is speaking? And I just began to pray and pray and pray and pray. And the Lord just revealed to me in no time, just 10 minutes, the Lord released my two children, the two younger ones, from curses that I had not broken, that I had not spoken against, things that had not come against. And the Lord will do that for you and for your children. Godly lineage. The Lord will bless you. You will drive and drive and drive, and you will use half the fuel that somebody else is using. They are both, you're born again and they are born again. Why? The difference is that they are pursued by curses. You are pursued by blessings. The blessings of the Lord are so amazing, and they pursue us. But they, first of all, they pursue us, they locate us, they jump on us, they overtake us. And if you are living in anything except that, you need to be aware that there are curses operational in your life and take the time to repent and to ask God, what is it? And you know, a lot of the curses in our lives are not even because of us. A lot of curses in our lives are because of something that your parents did. A lot of curses in your life are because of something your grandparents did. Covenants that remain unbroken. Things that you have allowed into your life, like a house girl you have allowed into your life. I remember having a house girl who I could not pray. For as long as this woman called Mwenessa was in my life, I could not pray in my house and I could not understand why. Please note, you will have a house. She plays certain songs that sound like godly songs, on a radio and everything. What is she doing? She's raising up an altar of darkness in your house because she believes in a different God than you do. She's not born again, but she's extremely spiritual and religious. What is she doing? There you are saying, she's so godly, she's so godly. What godliness is this that she's not a believer? She's not a born again Christian. What godliness is this that you're talking about? The Bible talks about a semblance of godliness. A semblance of godliness. Yes, lacking what? Yes. The Bible is so, so clear. It lacks the fear of God, and yet it appears to be a semblance of godliness. But you are so happy with the religious acts. You're so happy with that she's singing all the time. What is she raising an idol to if she's not a born-again Christian? Please note, idols are being raised up in our homes every single day. Altars are being raised in our homes every single day. Your child is even being taught songs of Babylon. They're not songs of godliness, but they mention Jesus somewhere. Which Jesus is this? I keep telling you guys, I was in France in 2015 and I met a man in Disneyland with a label written Jesus. Yeah, so I remember asking him, is your name Jesus? And he said, yes, my name is Jesus. I asked him sincerely, as in that's what's on your ID. The guy's flashing his ID and telling me, yes, my name is Jesus. There are many Jesuses. There are many Jesuses. Jesus is actually a very common name in some places, like in Central America and South America and everything. But which Yeshua is this? Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua HaMashiach. Guys, let us stop being ignorant. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6 says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. We lack knowledge. And you know the other thing is, we uphold men and women of God so much that if I send you a message telling you I'm praying for you it's enough. You relax. You stop praying. After all, you're sending your tithes and your offerings, which, by the way, if you're not praying for yourself and it's me who's praying for you or any other man or woman of God, then we become consultants. We become prayer consultants. Yeah. You cannot forsake the place of your personal prayer. You cannot forsake the place of you seeking God for yourself. God leads us in paths of righteousness, but we will only know when we know his voice. We need to learn to fast and to pray and to ask God, God, deal with me. Is there something? Does the devil has legal ground in my life? God, do a sanctification work in my life. Deal with me. Whatever it is that Satan would want to use, deal with me, Father. Is there anything? Is there anything? Is there anything, Father, that the enemy is using in my life? We must learn how to fast and pray for a spring cleaning in our lives that we may be able to move out of curses that we don't even realize and into blessing. Your grandmother used to practice witchcraft. You laugh about it and you've never taken time to repent. You know what? That witchcraft she was practicing, it may not affect you, but it will impact on your life one way or another, because the Lord is very clear that if you bow down to any idols, we are cast to four generations. You are within the curse of her life, even though you follow the Lord, pursue the Lord. You can know, by the way, that you are living on a path of curses. If there are things like marriage is breaking. Sorry, my daughter keeps opening the door to check whether I finished or not. And then she goes and please. So that's the banging you're hearing. Marriage is breaking. You have a whole line of marriages breaking. By the way, I come from a family where my mom and my dad, both of them are from divorced families, meaning my grandfathers on both sides were divorced. Both my grandmothers were brought for additional wives and they both said, no, I will not stand that. I will not take that, which is one of the jokes I tell my husband. I tell my husband, you know, if you go anyaying, you know me, I would have to leave you. Because if my grandmothers could say no, who am I to come many years later at it to agree? We come to an agreement, yeah? And you know, you've got to get to the place in your life where you see those things and you're able to pray. So for me, I wasn't ignorant. As I got married, I was a bit ignorant and I was getting married. But after some time of marriage, I began to realize, there's an altar here of divorce. There's an altar here where marriages don't work. And the Lord began to reveal to me, and I began to take long fasts, praying for my marriage, repenting for my grandparents, repenting for my grandmothers, repenting for my grandfathers, repenting for before them, because I didn't even know. I saw a polygamous streak in my family and also on my husband's side of the family. But the Lord is so faithful, by the way. God is so faithful. You continue to war and to cry to the Lord, you know, and the Lord actually sets free families as you war on your knees, repenting and crying to God and saying, God, I don't know what Satan is using, but God, if you would reveal it to me, I will repent. As for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. I will cry to you. And by the way, if you can unite with your spouse and pray like this and call on the Lord delivers. I have seen the Lord fixing long things of generational curses, things like, you know, things like broken marriages. If you will take time and check. By the way, let me tell you how curses operate. Eh? You will find that there will be a thing where, sorry, sweetie, you'll find that there's a thing where, first of all, it was people were not getting married. Eh? So you have a situation of people not getting married. Then you find that now somebody has prayed, interceded. So now people are getting babies outside of wedlock and not getting married. Then after some time of prayer, something shifts. Then you find somebody has now gotten married, but now there's a sense of divorce. So they're single parents, but at least they were married at some point. So you find that unless you pay attention to blessings and curses, they shift just a little bit with a little bit of prayer and fasting and calling on God. But unless you deal with them and wrestle with them, the Bible talks about in Ephesians chapter 6, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. So I don't know why we think we are punching Satan. We're not punching, we are wrestling. Yeah, we do not wrestle with flesh and blood. So somebody in the lineage needs to be able to cry out to God and say, no more, no more, no more, no more, no more. Like King David asked, is there no cause? Is there no cause? And then that's when he began to arise and declare. And remember the Philistine, Goliath, was cursing David. And then what had happened? David had worn the armor of Saul and it was oversized. And then he had to realize, you know what? I cannot go with the armor of Saul. Some of us use spiritual cover to go and enter into warfare. And yet that armor does not fit. The Lord gives us an armor which is our weapons of warfare that are not carnal, but are mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds. You cannot wear the armor of your spiritual dad. You cannot wear the armor of your spiritual mom. And by the way, there is spiritual cover and it is very, very powerful. And by the way, when you don't have spiritual cover, you're in trouble. But you must do spiritual warfare for your family, yourself, and call on the name of Jesus. Maybe with your siblings, if they're exposed to the things of God. Maybe with your spouse or your other people in the family. But cry to God and ask God, you know, to forgive you as a family. Go back in time and repent for the sins and feel as though they are yours. They're your sins. My grandmother was practicing witchcraft, Father. I repent, Lord God. It's not even funny. Lord God, I repent for her smoking of tobacco. I repent, oh Lord Jehovah God, for the way she beat up her husband. It's not funny, Lord. I repent for it, oh Lord Jehovah God. Because our spouse is an authority. And if we come against authority, there's a curse that comes against us because of coming against authority. Father, we repent because my mother moved us. I'm giving examples. Not, they're not true, actually, you know. But God, my mother started her own sect, started her own church, and rebelled against their church. God, I repent because there is a spiritual authority that the pastors have, the men of God have, the women of God have. I repent on behalf of my mother. I repent on behalf of my father, oh God, who started a sect and stole members of the church. I repent, oh Lord Jehovah, King of glory, for my father who was beating my mother. Lord God, because someone could beat up my daughters because my father was beating up someone else's daughter. I repent, oh God, because someone could end up beating me up. And by the way, let me tell you, sometimes some of the curses that will follow you are because of what your father did. If your father beats up somebody else's daughter, you will be beaten up a lot of times. And then what do the psychologists say? Abuse children, marry abusers. But no, the explanation spiritually is that the things that go round actually come round. And I know some people try to call them karma. Karma is Indian, okay? So I don't know which God you're following when you talk about karma, is a what, yeah? Those are, you know, by the way, let me tell you, our ignorance gets us into so many funny things. By the way, if you begin to declare karma or you say things like inshallah, you've already bowed down to the Indian gods. You've bowed down to Allah, who is not Jehovah. Ignorance. The lost people perish for lack of knowledge. I'm really feeling that we're in a season of revival. We are really. Even at Sozo Church, we are. But even at Sozo Church, you'll find that there are people in revival and there are people who are outside of revival. Why? Covenants that continue to speak. Altars that continue to speak in your life. And they stop you from having a breakthrough. You can be in the most powerful church and yet you're not getting your breakthrough. Why? Because there is a covenant that is unbroken that continues to speak. Because there is an altar that is unbroken that continues to speak. One of the things I tell people when their eyes are opened and they realize, I've been fellowshipping at a place of a false prophet and a diviner, one of the things I tell them is, you need to first of all forgive. The second thing you need to do is stop talking badly about them. Don't even tell people. It's not, you're not the people's Holy Spirit. And then take a moment and break those altars, because when you fellowship in a place, you must break the altar that is speaking in your life and the covenants that you got into. And then the Lord then, as you walk deliberately in obedience to God, the Lord then begins to bless you and to come upon you with heavy ways. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Some people tell me, oh, woman of God, I really want to meet you. I need to talk to you. I don't do meetings, by the way, with people who are outside of the church. Why? They're useless. We'll have a meeting of 3 hours or even 5 hours. But if you're still fellowshipping in the wrong place, how does that help? It doesn't help. And by the way, sometimes I go to pray for somebody and I can see a blockage. And one of the things I've come to learn is, where you fellowship, the altars actually speak. Because some of the men and women of God even say that you'll never be able to go to another altar. And even that thing of giving sadaka, taking offering to that altar. And then people say this altar will speak. Which altar is speaking? Which altar is speaking? It better be the right altar. It better be the altar of God. Otherwise, what happens is that when you leave that place, you find that your attachment to your blessings were as a result of that particular altar where you are fellowshipping. That is why a lot of children of God hear a fiery scripture. The Lord speaks to them. And then they say, oh my, I've been worshiping in the wrong place. This is a false prophet. This is a false teacher. And then you leave and then you die. Why? Because we don't understand how to deal with these things. We don't understand how to arise against them. We take them so lightly that we don't understand. If Jesus could ask Peter three times, Peter, do you love me? Three times. And Peter answers. Second time, Peter, do you love me? Three times. Then he says, feed my sheep. Peter was being commissioned, but God needed, Jesus, who is God, needed to destroy the altar of Peter having denied him three times. For me, God has asked me so many times, do you love me? But then he asked me so many times, I think I denied him more times than Peter. For sure I did. And that's the thing. If you spend time in the place of prayer, if you do not neglect the place of intimacy with God, if you choose to spend time with God and say, God, I love you, I want to seek you. Do not go away, darling. Come on in. Come in. Don't go away. Get into the car. And don't show your face on the screen, okay? All right. Yeah, because she's going to keep going and disappearing. If you truly desire God and hear the message and seek the Lord and keep coming into the presence of God and saying, God, I love you. God, I want to know you. God, I want to seek you. God, I want to pursue you. God, I just want to know you, Lord. I want more of you, Jesus. Then the Lord will begin bit by bit to reveal to you things. Because the Bible promises he leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. But there is a blessing that will only come when you forsake all others and seek the Lord God himself in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. May we learn to spend time in prayer, saying, God, I know there's been many others in generations past that came before me. Reveal to me if there's any generational curse, if there's anything, Lord, that we are accused of. And Lord God, show me how to cleanse the bloodlines in my family. If at all there's anything that is manifesting in your life that shows curses, including things like broken marriages, by the way. I get so concerned for the children of God that they don't understand that when you get into a situation where you're in a separation or you're in a divorce or you're in an unhappy marriage, that it means that there are curses manifesting themselves in your life. It is God's desire that you be married in a covenant marriage, born to a born-again Christian, and you raise a born-again children of God and keep on moving in the ways of God, and that you be happily married. They are happy marriages. I am happily married. I wasn't always happily married. I had to do some warfare on my marriage. Yeah. And my husband also had to do warfare on our marriage. But finally, we are happily married. We really love each other. We joke with each other. We play with each other. And our children are being raised up in a situation where they see that marriage is hard, yes, but marriage is a blessing. Marriage in the Lord is a blessing. When you walk with God, when you seek the Lord, when the two of you continue to submit yourselves to God individually, and then when you come collectively, you're able to submit yourselves to God together, jointly raising up godly generations. I believe our children will never know anything to do with an unhappy marriage. I believe that our children will never know anything to do with attacks on their marriages, because we are raising them up in full awareness that Satan walks around like a roaring lion. But also, if in the past generations there were broken marriages, there was polygamy, then it does come and bite. But we have broken that chain, that attack of Satan, and we have said it ends with us. So our children will not get into that. So guys, let us learn that the blessings of the Lord, they make rich and they add no sorrow. So if you find yourself in sicknesses, diseases that are not ending, I don't know my eczemas and I don't know, you know, my asthmas and all these chronic conditions that are there and you know, mental situations and everything, please note that there is a curse that is operational in your life. It's not the will of God that a curse be operational in your life. In fact, the Lord Jesus said that he came to set us free from the law of sin and death, and he has redeemed us in powerful ways, but you will perish and your family will perish for lack of knowledge. Let us not allow that to happen. Let us seek the Lord and ask God, what legal ground is Satan using? What legal ground is Satan using? What is Satan using? Tomorrow at the TSC, today we're describing curses, and tomorrow at the TSC, we will actually be taking time to explain how to get out of curses. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. We'll continue to minister as the Lord enables us. Please don't also go looking for curses when they are not there, okay? Don't go looking for curses when they are not there. But the Lord has blessed us. Let me tell you, by the way, the Lord... Yandy, the little girl has run away. Okay. The Lord has blessed us in such powerful ways that you know how God wants your life to be? That you're so blessed that during the time of worship, you can't stop crying. That's how my life is. That's how my life has become. I weep I weep. I have moments when I have to remind myself that I don't need to feel guilty for being blessed. Because I as the Lord led me to breaking covenants, evil covenants, wicked covenants, and altars of darkness in my life. One of the things that began to happen is that the Lord began to bless me so much that I began to say, Ibana God, I'm too blessed, oh Lord Jehovah God. Your blessings are so good. They are so sweet, Lord God. But Ibana God, you're blessing me so much and someone else really needs blessings. God, don't bless me for a while now. Just go to someone else. And even when you plead with the Lord to do that, by the way, he doesn't do that because he's a covenant God. He has to stick by his word. He has to stick with what he called you into. And he is faithful. And the thing is, when the Lord blesses you, you're so blessed to an overflow. The Lord provides for your rich needs according to his riches in glory. The Lord makes a way for you where there seems to be no way. You will find information about offers that are there that no one else would have found out about. You will find information about a destiny helpers. You will meet people so deliberately. Let me give you a final example. I met this wonderful lady from the TSC called Grasha. I know she didn't mind me mentioning her name. But through Grasha, I got to learn that Sitam is having a convention in Maryland on June, I think, 22nd. Now, as I was planning my mission to the States, the Lord was very clear. He wanted me to go to Washington, D.C. But somehow, as Georgia opened up, as Delaware opened up, I could not fix in Washington, D.C. because my friend in Virginia is the one who was supposed to take me. And somehow, you know, her work schedule and all those things. And we just said, you know, she's very prayerful. She's such a sweetheart. I love Jackie. Oh, wow. God gives you sisters. Eh? And, you know, we said, let's pray. And I kept telling the Lord, God, if you need me to be in Washington, D.C. to go and pray for the government of America from that contact point, I know somehow you'll make it be, you know. And I kept saying, God, I don't want to disobey you. Speak to me. So I meet Sister Grasha at the American Embassy. And we fellowship, it's the first time we are meeting. She's been following the page. And then she tells me about this convention. And I just find myself saying, I'll see you in Maryland. So we actually planned. I said, we're going to meet in Maryland. Yes, we are going to meet in Maryland. And I didn't quite know about it and what it was. But I love Bishop Oginde. And I really just wanted to go and hear him speak and everything. So, I ended up now saying I'm going to Maryland. Texas is not opening. Fine, I'll go to Maryland. I'll spend less days in Texas, in Dallas, and then da-da-da-da. Then, you know, as I send my main host, who is Sister Jackie in Virginia, as I send her the itinerary last night, I told her this is what the itinerary is looking like. And she laughed and she said, well, I guess it looks like you're going to Washington, D.C. and you're going to pray for Washington, D.C. So I was a bit confused. Then I said, sorry, what do you mean? She said, Dulles Airport. I don't know whether that's how it's pronounced, but D-U-L-L-E-S. You know, we're going to learn those twangs as we go along. But that particular airport is in Washington, D.C. And that's the airport I'm leaving from. My sister Bibiana also kept on insisting, instead of going back to Texas to take off from Texas the way you had wanted, why don't you just take off from Maryland? Why don't you take off from this particular airport instead of going to these places? And you know, it's different people, you know, that the Lord will just use. And I changed my flight, said, okay, I'll take off from this particular airport. And I was shocked to find that the airport is in Washington, D.C. The steps of a righteous man are ordered of God. They are. And you will keep moving, and because your life is surrendered to God, you're always saying, my life is not my own. Lord Jehovah God, every decision I make, it must be in the Holy Spirit. God, can I go to Maryland? God, can I go to Texas? Which state do you want me to go to? What do you want me to do in those states when I'm there? I also know that my schedule will change a whole lot when I'm in America. I know it because the Lord has told me. But for me, I've learned to surrender and say, God, have your way. God, have your way. You need me to come back earlier, I'll come back earlier. You need me to come back later, I'll come back later. You know, when I was coming from Australia, I came back earlier, you know, because the Lord said, come back earlier. So it's all about how long I'll be there or what I'll do. When the work of the Lord is finished, we go out. But why am I giving you this example? It's not just for people who are called into ministry. By the incidental, you know, all of us are in ministry, right? The moment you're born again, you're a priest. The Bible says you're a royal priesthood. Yeah, so you are already a priest. Wherever you are in ministry. I tell people who are employed and they say, oh, I want to be in full-time ministry like you. Even when you are employed, you are in ministry at your workplace. You are actually sent on an assignment at your workplace. So learn to obey God. Learn not to separate. This is my Christian walk with God and this is my secular walk with God. Christians have no secularism, okay? When you're at work, you're a Christian in the workplace. When you are in the marketplace, you're a Christian in the marketplace. When you're in the gym, you're a Christian in the gym. And speaking of the gym, by the way, you know me, I carry my own headset. Because me, I don't do secular music. So I don't know, you're a Christian, but in the gym, you're there allowing yourself to listen to secular music. You know, God's people perish for lack of knowledge. May the Lord help us to walk with him and to remember that the blessings of the Lord, they make rich and they add no sorrow. And when we walk deliberately with God, he will reveal things to us so that we can get out of curses, get out of funny things. Some of us are married to people we have no business being married to because you got into covenants with an unbeliever. That continues to speak. Yeah, that continues to speak. Because if you are in a covenant with an unbeliever, then you have united yourself to their gods. You have united yourself to their gods. And it's serious. And their gods continue to speak. And these are the things, you know, when the Lord says, do not be unequally yoked. Imagine he just, you know, some people think that God is a party pooper, you know. You know, he just doesn't want you to have fun. Some people think that God just wants you to get into a situation where, you know, life is so boring and so dreary and life really sucks and, you know, Christianity sucks. Let me tell you, I have not had as much fun as I've had in the last 6 years with God. And really, I would say 26 years, even though, you know, for the first 20 years, I was a bit disobedient. But man, my life is fun. I have fun. I have so much joy. I enjoy myself. As in, by the way, I used to be addicted to carnival. Even when I was born again, I used to think at a super soul. Then I'll come out of there feeling empty. You know, nowadays, by the way, I listen to all those secular songs and I'm like, I don't need them. They are not fun. They're not anything. May I have a Holy Ghost party in my house, by the way. Yeah? I put on worship and I begin to dance. I know who I am. I dance. I go crazy. And my children have learned about what that is all about. You know, because I have shown them that God is fun. And my teenage children turn to people and tell them, me, by the way, God is fun. God rocks. The other day, we had an 18-year-old, Rachelle, who came with us somewhere. First of all, we went somewhere, then, you know, we were having a good time, you know, in the Lord, of course. And then she came for another fellowship, but this time it was for older people. And when we were done, she said, "Hiya, you mean being saved is fun? You guys are fun. You guys are cool. I thought you guys are old and I'm going to get bored, but Mazi, I've not laughed the way I've laughed." Yes, Christianity is fun. Christianity is fun. The fun began, the parties in heaven. Satan is the one who has thought that he can come with a counterfeit party, because a lot of the people who were born again initially had a lot of problems. There were two shows, you know, there were people from, you know, reserved people who didn't understand the goodness of God. The Bible says that the devil comes, Lucifer comes to steal, to kill, to destroy. But Jesus comes. In fact, he says, I have come. That you may have life and have it abundantly. Not he came. I have come. That you may have life and have it abundantly. And let me tell you, Jesus rocks. God rocks. God is fun. And the thing is, you can have the kind of fun where you don't have to worry about the consequences. It's actually fun. I have Christian friends and we have such a good time. Yesterday, we went and sat down somewhere and we were just talking and sharing and laughing and loving on each other. And, you know, just telling each other how special the other person is and everything. And we have no hang-ups. Making true friends. And you know, there's something else I like to say, and I want to close with this one, that blood is thicker than water. Yeah, that's what we use when we're talking about our family members, isn't it? But there's something else that is thicker than blood, and that is spirit. And I have had born-again Christians open up their homes to me. Born-again Christians love me more than my own family. I have grown to love people more than I've ever known love, you know. I grew up in a home where we were fighting most of the time and dysfunctional most of the time. Yeah, and Esther Wangwe, you're one such person, you know. People who I walk with and we love each other so deeply. Danielle, I can see you peeping, yeah, from a distance. You know, people who I've gotten to know and we love each other so deeply, so deeply, so deeply. By the way, you know, you hold each other and you're like, hey, what is this? This is love. Yes, that's the family of Christ. People who will give a kidney for you if they need to. People will take a bullet for you if need be. What is it? Spirit. Blood is thicker than water, but spirit is thicker than blood. Okay, and after all, we're under the blood of Jesus Christ. That's a blood that speaks. And God is so faithful and he's so worthy and he's wonderful. And you know, the Christians, nobody had any issues with them. The first Christians, nobody had any issue with them. They people even feared them and they wouldn't dare join them unless they were born again Christians. Why? They were following the true Christ. We've sold Jesus to be someone else he's not. And the Lord is faithful and he's worthy. He is absolutely awesome and wonderful. I welcome you to this party that is of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you that there is no better fun than being born again and following Yeshua HaMashiach and living for him. And he blesses us. We are blessed abundantly over and beyond everything. God bless you so much. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May you come face to face with the real Jesus. May you come face to face with the real Jesus. If your Christian life sucks, you're not following the real Jesus. If you feel like you're in a little prison and you just need to breathe, you are in another prison, which is not of the Lord Jesus Christ. And really, Jesus Christ sets us free, and we tell him, oh, I want to be bound in you. I want to be in you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Love you guys. Let's continue to pray. Let's continue to seek the Lord. Let's continue to love on him. Let's continue to walk with him in all ways. Do not look to the left or to the right. Worship the Lord and follow him with everything. Choose to obey him. Then the real fun begins. The real fun begins. He is awesome. Hallelujah. God bless you. Hallelujah.